Welcome back to the Nourishing Life program. I'm Dr. Saraswati, and this is the Tao of Food. In our last session, we described Nourishing Life as a self-care and medical program that offers a new paradigm and solutions for women's health issues of all kinds. But particularly, we're geared towards helping women to learn how to maintain or reclaim their fertility. Sometimes that means working to regulate menstrual problems like amenorrhea due to PCOS or painful periods related to endometriosis. We also help women with postpartum recovery and the process of getting back to themselves after the birthing process. And we help the variety of issues women face during perimenopausal transition. We work with women of all life stages, and I'm struck by how often I see women who just don't feel well. They're dealing with weight gain that no amount of exercise seems to help, with low energy levels, high stress levels, a completely dismal sex drive, or feeling overly emotional. Some deal with foggy thinking or even depression and anxiety. Others have lost interest in connecting with their partners. I want you to know that many of these issues have a hormonal underpinning, and once your hormones are brought into balance, you will feel better. Once you're living from your source energies of Jing, Qi, and Shen, you will begin to move the needle in some of these challenging symptoms. It all begins with creating the life you want right now. These are the six modules that we take you through to help you maintain your fertility, balance your hormones, and resolve your symptoms. I hope you enjoyed the first two sessions together and that you've been able to see yourself a little differently as you've explored where health meets consciousness. We began this journey of health restoration with the Tao of Beginning, where you explored a new way of understanding your own health and your relationships to your environment. Then last week, we discussed the Tao of Essence and how your essence, or your Jing, is an analog for your hormones and that it forms the very foundation of your source energies. And it's what supports all of the fundamental energies in your whole body mind. As you learn how to skillfully conserve your Jing essence, your fertility is maintained, and your hormones are more balanced, and you age more gracefully. This week, our focus is on the Tao of Food. Food has the most important self-care influence on the earth element, the very centerpiece of the wheel, and what gives your day-in, day-out usable power to harness your own healing energy. And here you can see that the earth element is at the very center of the wheel of your source energies. Here, with this energy of the earth represented by the spleen and stomach inside the body, we want to cultivate the very energy here so that we support our moment-to-moment, day-in, day-out presence, which ultimately gives awareness to the choices you are making in your life so that they become more skillful. This is all part of working at the level of qi, your interaction with your own life. All of this occurs at the level of the spleen and stomach. This is how you leverage your lifestyle and self-care expressions to work for you and not against you. So let me break this down a little bit. Concentration and awareness means to really be awake to your life. And this all belongs to the spleen and stomach and to the element of the earth. So if your qi is strong, you have a greater capacity to be present and therefore skillful. And when your qi is deficient, or you're nutrient deficient or fatigued, just to name a few, you have a lessened capacity to make healthy choices with your energy expenditures. My friend and yogini, Katie Silcock, sums this up beautifully when she says, When we are balanced, our senses actually feed our good choices. When we're out of balance, they send us towards people, places, foods, and forms of entertainment that bring us into deeper states of imbalance. I mean, this is so beautifully said and exactly in alignment with this idea of how our habits perpetuate our own pathology. So this process of how we establish our footing, being firmly grounded into the earth from which we can pause, breathe, and then notice we are in our habits. Habits, by definition, are unconscious behaviors. Habits are a result of a two-part process where we are triggered and this results in a reaction. The trigger could be anything, an emotion, a stressor, a lack of sleep, and then we react from that place. And what we want to cultivate is more of a three-part process. We still have an experience in which we're being triggered, but the second part of the process is what we want to cultivate, what we've called in our last sessions, the gap, an open awareness, a noticing. From this presence, this third step is that we can then pivot and point our energy skillfully toward a direction and a choice that works for us and towards our health goals and maintains resonance within. As our earth element, the spleen stomach, gets stronger and more vital, we move from a life of unconscious habits and trigger reaction to one of radical presence. From trigger to presence to response. Any action becomes dharmic when followed by contemplation. So what does this all have to do with hormones and food? So let's understand and connect the dots here. Believe it or not, many women find themselves turning towards foods and eating behaviors that don't really serve them. We're trying to unravel that a little bit here. I really want you to understand that the ability to hold presence in the gap is an expression of robust chi. And the best way to get that is by eating nutrient-dense foods. Nutrient-dense foods are potent building blocks for achieving self-care and longevity. And longevity here means extending your fertile years, reclaiming your fertility, maintaining your fertility amidst a busy, hectic life, and also healthy aging. That is how to pass into your post-reproductive years in a happy, healthy, vibrant, authentic way. So let's step back a moment to understand the role of chi. We've already described it as source energy that dominates the way we interact with our life. Chinese medicine has the understanding of how qi functions in the body, how it's made, how it circulates, what helps make it, and what spends it. It's interesting to note that Western science understands that there are three behaviors that have a healing, reparative impact across the whole body-mind, and that if you do these things on a regular basis, your qi will get stronger and you will become more balanced. These are eating nutrient-dense foods, exercise, and meditation or relaxation techniques. And these are the very same three practices that help you to cultivate your energy and to conserve it. Here's a pretty detailed image that we will look at more deeply in other sessions, but what I'd like you to notice here is this is part of the solution of how you actually spend your energy and how you actually save your energy. So notice here that qi is at the center and that it is actually drained by stress. But you increase your qi by eating well and breathing well. And in terms of breath, we're talking especially when you take deep, relaxing belly breaths. At the end of your day, you will have a surplus of qi left over. And that actually gets stored in your deep reservoir, your foundational source energy, into your kidneys as Jing essence. This is what replenishes you, creates more stress resilience, and boosts your hormones. So remember, each module has three sections to understand, so we get into really looking more deeply into some of the content. Then there's a part where you self-study, where you examine, what am I doing? And then integration of how can I use this information in my life. This module gives you a taste of the role of the earth element and the function of qi in terms of changing the course of your healing direction. And again, one of the most potent ways to do that is through food. Not only the food that you eat, but how you eat it, when you eat it, where you eat it, the quality of food, if it's packed in a freezer, if it's just been plucked off a tree, you can imagine the amount of qi that's in that food is completely different. And then, of course, regulating blood sugar, but we'll talk about that just very briefly later. But something to really understand about blood sugar, that's probably the most important thing you can make a change with today to positively impact your own hormones, is really dialing in your ability to balance your blood sugar. So these are the five elements. Next to each element, the step of the Nourishing Life program is listed, and this is the element's most helpful self-care yangsheng solution. Because it's a correlative system, the self-care solution today are foods and how they're used to head up the whole category as we dive more deeply into an exploration of the earth element. Let's look at whole life ways to lift up your earth element by examining your rhythm, foods, and feelings. So let's do a little experiment in terms of self-study by really looking at your food intake, your rhythm of eating, and how that relates to your menstrual cycle, if applicable, your feelings, the timing of how you're eating, and also any physical symptoms that you experience. So make sure to download your diet diary PDF. So first, what we'll start with is a review of your last 3 days of food. So do the best you can to fill in that part of the information. Often when we start a program, we get really good with our diet. So maybe think back and remember, what have you eaten, around what times did you eat, with what kind of regularity and rhythm, and any kind of experiences you had, either physical or emotional. And then continue to use your diary over the next 7 days or longer, and again, include food and drink, the time you ate, the day of your cycle, symptoms experienced, meaning a physical symptom, or any emotional feelings that occur. So after you have all of this, you'll notice from information comes power and change. The Tao of Food deepens into the exploration of all of these topics. Exactly what are nutrient-dense foods, blood sugar balance, the yin and yang of foods, and with that, how to eat for your own constitution. That is, if you are more excessive in your body nature or more deficient, if you're more hot, if you're more cold, how do you dial in your foods to help every day to lift up and balance and heal your body? And then what are the best hormone balancing foods? We go over these much more deeply in a personal appointment, because it's all individualized. So we can give you general ideas here. We also can deal with this content in a workshop setting. Over these last 15 minutes or so, we have shown how habits perpetuate your pathology and how consciousness enlivens your qi, enabling you to make healthy, skillful choices. We began the conversation of the spleen's ability to either save or spend your chi, and that the more chi you accumulate, then a surplus remains to be stored down into your kidneys as jing. To help deepen this understanding, we will put into action with self-study and your own diet diary. Now, integration is making it real. That what the spleen likes is rhythm and movement. This is how we'll deal with integration. So these are some general rules of thumb, but things to add in and integrate into your life starting right now. Eat regular meals at regular times, every 2 to 3 hours. Drink your food and eat your water. That means really focus on chewing and take your water or drinks away from your digestive process. So try not to take drinks during your mealtime. Walk 100 steps after dinner or sweep the floor. We really want to get into some exercise, a little bit of movement after you eat. And if it's rainy out or the weather doesn't suit you, the ancient literature actually suggests you do something vigorous like sweeping the floor. Eat with presence and with a positive feeling of gratitude and relaxation. Don't flood the spleen. That means this idea of drinking too much. Don't chill the spleen. So the spleen likes to be warm. We think of it almost like a cooking pot. So we want to keep the ability for it to extract energy really strong. So it doesn't like cold foods. Choose foods with a strong life force. Stop just before you're full and trust your body. Eat with your heart. It means enjoy your food. And have good judgment. So really be the wise judge. And with that, we think that you're using your gallbladder to eat. And again, support the spleen by reducing the following. Avoid or limit alcohol, caffeine, sugar, dairy, wheat, and processed foods. Limit refined carbohydrates. Those turn straight into sugar and they're empty calories and they really fluctuate your blood sugar wildly. Limit low-fat and non-fat cow's milk. We really want you to think about taking full fat because that gives good influence to healthy fats in your body which form the substrate of hormones. Really limit sugar and sweeteners. The only appropriate sweetener to use is stevia. Avoid hormonally treated animal products. And again, coffee, alcohol. Please limit cold or raw foods. Keep your blood sugar balanced by eating every 2 to 3 hours. Eat until you are 70% full, then stop. That usually takes about 20 minutes. So eat slowly, chew well, be mindful. And after about 20 minutes of eating, you can stop. And avoid eating 3 hours before going to sleep. This helps to keep your digestive fire strong and prevent any kind of stagnation that occurs when you eat and then just go right to sleep. Your next module will be the Tao of Body, where we continue the conversation of how we interact with life from the level of qi and how the body is involved in that process of saving and spending your qi. I'll share specific yoga practices next week and postures that will support your hormone meridians, hormone productions, and I'll teach you the best technique to bank your jing down into your pelvic bowl. We'll talk about all of that next time. As usual, if you have any questions at all about this material, please reach out to us at info@nourishinglife.com or please give us a call, 1-800-215-5020. And I'm wishing you may have peace with ease along your healing path.